Amen. Well, welcome to Lifehouse Church, everyone. Before we get started, if you would just bow your heads, let's just pray and ask God to not only anoint my words, but to soften your heart to receive His word this morning. Heavenly Father, we just want to do just that, God, that you would put the words in my mouth. God, what I speak, God, is coming from your word, God, and it's according to your will today. And I pray, God, as we talked last week, what you had come to do, Jesus, that is to save the lost, to set people free and to heal them, God. And I pray this morning that that would be done today as we speak your word. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen, amen. All right, well, we've been looking over the last 4 weeks now at a series, God Calls Me, and we're looking at a few names that are in his word that God calls those people that submit to his will. And kind of in review, I've said week after week that it's really up to you to choose who you're going to listen to. Are you going to listen to the world and what the world says about you? And is that going to be what defines who you are? Or are you going to listen to the truth of what God says in his word, who you are? Because the fact is this, that what you choose to believe about yourself is going to be that which defines who you are. And therefore, that will determine your actions. And that what determines your actions will dictate what you're going to achieve in life. So again, we're looking at the names that God has in his word that he's calling those people that submit their life to him. So in review, we have looked at four names so far that God not only calls us saved, and again, I want to make sure that we're clear this morning, that you are saved by grace through faith, okay? You're not saved by anything else that you do, okay? It's that Jesus died on the cross. It's through his blood that removes your sin. It's through his righteousness that's imputed into your account. That is how we're saved, okay? Because we're going to look in just a minute at the disciplines of a disciple, and I want to make sure that you distinguish that we are not talking about a works-based salvation, okay? You are saved by grace. We talked about that 4 weeks ago. If you weren't here, you can go online and listen to that as well. So that's the first thing we talked about. The second thing we looked at, Ryan came and shared about Israel, that you have been grafted into the body of Christ through Israel, through Ephraim and Manasseh. So again, we've been grafted into the body, and the promises of God that we see throughout the Word of God apply to you as well. So again, there's some great promises that we see in the Word of God. And again, you got to know that this is for you, okay? Everything is for you to build you up, all right, and to train you up in righteousness. So you have been grafted in to the kingdom of God. Also, we talked about that you're an overcomer. Not you don't overcome on your own, but we are victorious because of the work that Jesus Christ did as well. And then last week, if you're here, we shared a message that you are also called healed. Okay, not only spiritually, not only mentally, but physically as well. That God is able, God is willing. If we receive him, we apply the blood that that he will and wants to bring a healing to us. So again, those are the four things we talked about. But today we're going to move on. We're going to talk about something that's probably going to be a little bit more intense. So as we get going on this, you might want to reach under your seats and put your seatbelts on a little bit because there's going to be a little turbulence as we go through this, all right? Because we are to be called his disciples. Okay, we're to be called his disciples. Now, what exactly is a disciple? I've got this disciple vow that I want to show to you.
I am a part of the fellowship of the unashamed. I have Holy Spirit power. The die has been cast. I have stepped over the line. I am a disciple of his. I won't look back, let up, slow down, back away, or be still. My past is redeemed. I'm finished with low living, sight walking, smooth knees, colorless dreams, pain vision, mundane talking, and dwarf goals. I don't have to be right, first, top, recognized, praised, regarded, or rewarded. I now live by faith, lean on his presence, walk by patience, live by prayer, and labor by power. My faith is set, my gate is fast, my goal is heaven. My road is narrow, my companions few. My God, reliable. My mission clear. I cannot be bought, compromised, detoured, lured away, turned back, or delayed. I will not flinch in the face of sacrifice, hesitate in the presence of the adversary, or negotiate at the table of the enemy. I won't give up, shut up, let up, until I have stayed up, stored up, prayed up, paid up, preached up for the cause of Christ. I am a disciple of Jesus. I must go until he comes, give till I drop, preach till all know, and work till he stops me. And when he comes for his own, he will have no problem recognizing me.
vow of a disciple of Christ, that my banner will not be clear, that I will continue to keep on keeping on. This is what you're called to be. Now, the question that comes up, though, is who or what defines what a disciple of Christ is? And let me maybe broaden that a little bit more. Who or what defines what a Christian is? Okay, because here's the fact is this, that the word Christian and the word disciple are actually the same thing. Okay, you cannot be a Christian without being a disciple. You cannot be a disciple without being a Christian. They go together. We look in the book of Acts, and that's what it says, Acts 11:26. It says the disciples were first called Christians at Antioch. Okay, so again, these two words, they go together, okay? A disciple is a Christian is a disciple, okay? So this is the issue that we need to identify in America. What or who defines what a disciple or what a Christian is? Who or what defines what behavior that a disciple or a Christian, how they need to behave? Who defines that? Now, last week I was walking around and I've been kind of looking around Lifehouse a little bit more in the morning and popping my head in some of the classes or whatever. And last week I popped into Jake's class. I don't know where you are, Jake, but over here. But kind of popped my head in there to see what was going on in there. And of course, he's got a lot of people his age in there, college students and that kind of thing. And one of the college students saw me and she said, "Hey, would you consider speaking at this Jesus Awareness Week we have at Hastings College?" I said, "You know, I would kind of consider it." And I said, "Well, what's the deal?" And she said, "Well, what the topic is going to be about is why does the world view Christians as hypocrites? Why are Christians labeled hypocrites within this world?" And the question is good, okay? Because again, why are Christians labeled hypocrites? But the fact is this: it kind of burns a hot spot in my belly to hear that, because it shouldn't be that way. And what the problem is, it's the result of misdefining really what a Christian is. You know what I'm talking about? When we allow the culture to define what a Christian is, what we do is we end up with a lot of people that have a label of Christian upon them that don't possess any type of characteristics of what Jesus defines what a disciple of Christ is. Listen to me, going to a church, if you're sitting in here today, this doesn't make you a disciple. It doesn't make you a Christian to sit in a church. Matter of fact, I hate to break the news to you, but it doesn't make you a disciple of Christ to come down in an emotional fit and pray one prayer and never live for Christ again. That doesn't make you a Christian either. That doesn't make you a disciple of Christ. It doesn't make you a disciple of Christ because maybe your family for generations and generations called Jesus Christ Lord. That does not make you a disciple. That doesn't make you a Christian. Matter of fact, I hate to tell you this, but just because you live in America doesn't mean you're a Christian. And I don't care what kind of start that America had, because it did have a Christian background, but I think that everybody said, "Hey, I'm American, I'm Christian, okay?" And I know that our country's getting further away from that, but for years, that was the deal. "Oh, you're American, you're Christian." No, that's not the deal. Because you're sitting here in church doesn't make you a Christian any more than attending a Husker football game makes you a football player. You know what I'm talking about? Just because you're sitting in the stands at a Husker football game does not mean Bo Pelini is going to say, "Get out of the stand, put the equipment on, and come out and play," right? It doesn't. See, to be a Husker football player, there's a discipline that comes with that. There's a behavior that comes with it. There's training that comes with it. There's recruiting that comes with it. There's all kinds of things that takes place in order that you get out of the stands and go stand on that field and be called a true Husker, right? And guess who defines that? This guy defines that, right? Bo Pelini is the head coach, and you can see he's laying down the law here. This is what a Husker football player is going to be, okay? You're going to be as disciplined. You're going to listen to me, and if you don't listen to me, you're going to have the wrath of Bo Pelini upon you, right? Well, listen, to be on God's team, you've got a head coach as well. You know who the head coach of God's kingdom is? Jesus. He's so-called the head coach. Jesus is the truth. He is the word, and he is the one that defines what his disciples are and how they are going to act. The world doesn't define that. It's Jesus that defines that. And by the way, he wants great depth on his team. He wants all of you to be part of his team. But he is going to be the one that defines how you act as a disciple of Christ. And I'm not talking about a works-based salvation. What I'm saying here is once you have been saved, there is a discipline, there's behaviors of a person that has been saved. Okay? You are saved by grace through faith, okay? But the evidence that you've been saved is that there's a change in behavior. Okay, are we clear on that? And Jesus Christ is the one that determines and defines what your behavior should be like as a true disciple of Christ. Now look at this in John 13. As I start to dig into, again, not my sermons, but the sermons of Jesus. Okay, now, you got your seatbelts on, all right? Because again, it's going to get a little convicting here maybe, because anytime we listen to the sermon of Jesus Christ, okay, you're gonna be challenged. John 13, verse 34. It says, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this, all will know that you are my disciple if. He doesn't say everybody's my disciple, but he says, you are my disciple if. So there's a condition here, right? Isn't that what the word, isn't that what if means? That there is something that comes after if that you've got to follow in order to be his disciples, okay? So again, that everybody will know that you are my disciples if you love, you have a love for one another, okay? So again, there is a behavior, okay, an action, a way to live, okay, that gets you to be the place to get you to be a disciple that God is calling you to be. Again, he's not saying here that everybody is my disciple, but you're my disciple if you are in this type of behavior is what he's talking about here. And the fact is this, that when we look at this, he says, by this, all will know that you are my disciple. Okay, so he wants you to be his disciple. That's what he wants. Luke 14, Jesus, he's addressing the congregation, kind of like what I'm doing this morning. Jesus had a church, and it was the fastest growing church you've ever seen. I mean, he had 15, 20,000 people following him all over the place. And many people were coming to church. Just like in America, just like in the world, they come to church, okay? They come for religious reasons. They come because that's what they're supposed to do. They come because they want to maybe be tickled a little bit, or they want to be part of some movement or something like that. And this is what was going on. He's talking to the congregation as I'm talking to you today, but you've got to understand something. Jesus was never a preacher of comfort. He was always a preacher of the truth. And anytime the truth is preached, there's going to be a decision that you're going to have to make. You cannot just sit there when Jesus Christ preaches and think that you're just going to sit there comfortable. Jesus is going to challenge you. He's going to make you come to decision. Are you going to follow me or are you going to follow the world? And that's what we see here. And what we see in Luke 14, he begins to talk about, again, more discipline that a disciple will have that follows him. And in verse 25, it starts out and says, now the great multitudes went with him. Okay, so again, there's a lot of people that were following him. And it goes on and says, and he turned and said to them, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and his mother, his wife and children, his brothers and sisters, and yes, his own life, he cannot be my disciple. So again, he's saying here, not everybody's going to be my disciple. I mean, put yourself in this picture. Sorry, I'm stepping out of the light here, but anyway, sorry, people on the video. Can you imagine being in that congregation when he's preaching that? And you got to put yourself in their place because it was just like you and I today. I mean, there are real people walking with this man, okay, called Jesus, okay? He's preaching these messages. They're following him around. People are saying he's the Christ, okay? And they're all going, oh, what's he going to say today? And they're all following him stuff. And he's looking back going, who are you? You know, are you really? And I don't know. I'm just picturing him. Maybe he's kind of getting a little agitated by all these people that just want to be fluffed up and everything. And he comes to them like this, Kevin, and he says, you want to follow me? You really want to be my disciple? Is this your wife? Then you hate her. You hate her. Okay? You got kids? You need to hate them too. You got a mom? You got a dad? Hate them as well. Can you imagine what they were thinking when he stood up and says, Stan, you need to hate Troy. Can you imagine what they're thinking? And then he goes on and he says, and whoever does not bear his cross and come after me, he cannot be my disciple. So unless you hate her, unless you carry your own cross, you're not my disciple. That's what he's saying right there, okay? I'm just reading what's on there, right? Okay, now we talked about this a couple weeks ago. Now, he wasn't literally meaning hate your wife, hate your kids, hate your mother and father. But what he's talking about here is a comparison of commitment here. He's saying in comparison, of how much you love me. It should be like you hate your wife, you hate your kids, you hate your family. That should be the level of commitment. Boy, guys, this should be an examination for everyone here. Because he's saying here, if you don't, you can't be my disciple. Is there a little examination going on here? It is for me. Because if you don't have that type of commitment for Christ, is what, again, I'm not saying this, is what Jesus is saying, you can't be my disciple. And he talks about carrying this whole cross thing around. What does a cross represent? It represents persecution. It represents abuse. It represents sacrifice that the world will place upon a true disciple. It says, if you're not carrying that around, okay, then you cannot be my disciple. Are you carrying around persecution? Are you carrying around the abuse, the sacrifice, because people know that you are following the living God and they're after you, they don't like what you're doing? Are you carrying your cross? See, guys, the fact is this, that when we look at how Jesus is defining what a disciple of Christ is, okay, he's saying, you know what? It's not going to be an easy road for anybody. The comforts of the world, they're not there for you. He's saying, you're going a different direction than the world. The fact is, each one of us have a choice. That's what Jesus is saying. And what you need to do, as he continues on here, he's saying, you need to count the cost. Go and count the cost, whether you want to follow me or not. Because it's not an easy road. And that's where he goes on here in verse 28. And he says this, for which of you intending to build a tower does not sit down first and count the cost, whether he has enough to finish it, lest after he has laid the foundation and is not willing to finish, all who see it begin to mock him, saying, this man began to build and he was not able to finish. Okay, so if you're saying that you're a disciple of Christ, you're saying that Jesus is my Lord, okay, you better count the cost, because Jesus is saying then there's going to be some sacrifice. Is this not going to be an easy life for you? Are you willing to continue to see that through? Because if not, the world's going to look at you and say, see, I told you. He's calling himself a follower of Christ. He's just like the world. And they're going to begin to mock you. And it goes on here further, and he says, or what king is going to make war against another king and not sit down and first consider whether he's able with 10,000 to meet him who comes against with 20,000? Or else while the others is still a great way off, he sends delegation and ask conditions of peace. So likewise, whoever does not forsake all. Is that a challenge right there? Whoever does not forsake all that he has cannot be my disciple. And guys, don't get mad at the messenger here. I'm just reading what Jesus wrote, right? What he said? If you got a problem with this, you take it up with Jesus. This is what he said, okay? And this is the problem with American Christianity. And this is why Christians have been labeled hypocrites, because Jesus comes and he defines, this is what you are as a disciple of Christ. This is how you need to behave. And the world comes and says, you know what? The cost is just too high for me. And what happens is you begin to mix worldly pleasures, but you still proclaim that Christ is your Lord. And the world's looking at us and saying, you know what? There is so much inconsistency within the body, the so-called body of Christ. I mean, they're not good for anything. And we lose our influence because we don't practice what we preach. Hate to give too much credit to other false religions and everything, but I'll tell you what. You look at like the Muslim faith, most of them practice what they preach, don't they? And because of that, they've got and have growing influence going on right now. You don't hear too many people calling Muslims the hypocrites. They're called radicals. All kinds of stuff, but they follow what's in their word. But we look at Christianity nowadays, and again, that's the tag that we have. They're a bunch of hypocrites. They don't practice what they preach. They always put these labels upon things, but they go and do the same thing. What goes on here? I should say Jesus does. Luke 14, verse 34. And this is what he talks about. He just explained what it is to be a disciple of Christ, okay, that you need to live this way. And again, please, please understand, I am not saying it's a works-based religion. I'm saying once you are saved by the grace of God, the demonstration that you have been saved is a life change. And Jesus said, if you truly are saved and understand who I am, you're going to live this way. But it goes on, and if you don't live this way, he said in verse 34, salt is good, but if the salt loses its flavor, how shall it be seasoned? So if you are out there saying, I'm a follower of Christ, okay, I'm a disciple of Christ, I follow the Word of God, and you're living a life inconsistent with that, and you lose your testimony, then it says, okay, then how are you going to get your seasoning back? You've already lost that influence. Verse 35, it says, and it is neither fit for the land, and I love Jesus, he's pretty direct here, or for the dunghill. I can just see him preaching this stuff, you know. He's looking over, he's telling the story, and he's going, you're not fit, if you don't live this way, you're not fit for any of this. And he looks over and sees this pile of manure. He says, and you're not even fit for that. I mean, he's a hardcore preacher here. He says, but the men, they take it and they throw it out, okay? So they take your testimony and say, it's not worth anything. Get out of here. I'm not going to listen to you. And then he closes with this. He who has ears, let him hear. Anybody have spiritual ears today? Pretty quiet here in this place this morning. He who has ears, let him hear. Are you hearing what Jesus is preaching here? I am just reading his word. This is a life-challenging word. And Jesus, when he preaches, you have got to make a choice. That's what Jesus does. You choose either me or you choose the world. He's not a preacher of comfort by all means, but he is always demanding a decision from you. Are you going to follow me, or are you going to follow the comforts of this world? And I hate to tell you this, but we're going to see in a minute that many people walked away. They said, I can't do it. John chapter 6, Jesus is teaching again. He's teaching a hard message again. He's saying, you know what? I am the way, the truth. He's saying, I am the bread of life. And he's looked at everybody and says, you know what? As a true disciple of Christ, you feed on nobody else except me. Me and me alone, that's who you feed upon. And the people look at him and say, you've got to be kidding. Well, what's this guy preaching? And these are his disciples looking at this. And this is what it says in John 6, verse 60. After he just preaches that, saying, you need to feed on me. There is going to be a crucified life coming on, and you need to feed on me, is what he's saying here. And in verse 60, it says, therefore many of his disciples. Now, Jesus had more than the 12 disciples. He had a lot of followers, and that what disciple means, a follower or a learner. So he had a whole horde of people that were following him. And it goes on here, and it says, many of those, and that word many is the word polos, and polos means majority. It means above the average, okay? So it means, well, it means majority, okay? So he says, therefore, many or above the majority, okay, of his disciples, when they heard this, they said, this is a hard saying. Who can understand it? And as I'm preaching this word today, I don't know if there's anyone out here saying, this is a hard teaching. Who can understand it? But you're in the same ballpark as a lot of these disciples here. And verse 61, it says, when Jesus knew in himself that his disciples complained about this, he said to them, does this offend you? And again, I think Jesus was in people's faces. I think he gave this preaching and they're grumbling and stuff. And he looked and says, is this offending you, Stan? Huh? Is this a problem to you? You guys need to sit on the front row. See what you get? You get beat up, all right? You didn't walk in the front row when Jesus was preaching, okay? Because he probably would turn to you and say that, do you got a problem with this, huh? This is the truth, okay? This is what I'm sharing is what Jesus said. And if you got a problem with it, tough. I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. What I say goes is what he would say. And if you got a problem with it, well, then you're just going to have to walk away. And again, Jesus poses that same question to everyone here. You got a problem with this teaching? Does this offend you? Again, this isn't me preaching. Don't look at me. Okay, this is his word. Do you have a problem with this? He's asking you this morning through his word. Or does this make you really examine your life as a disciple of Christ? Now, you want to see the result of the teaching? Because there's some people in here that are probably feeling the same way right now. John 6, verse 66 says, from that time, many, again, the majority of his disciples, many of his disciples went back and walked with him no more. Said, I can't handle this. You know, we can't take this, Jesus. And then Jesus looked at the 12. He looked at them and says, you want to go too? You got a problem with this too, you 12? Then you can get out of here too, because I'm not going to hold back. I'm going to preach the word is what Jesus said. I'm going to preach the truth and you know, let there be division if not. And he looked at the 12 and says, are you going to go with them? It says, Simon Peter. He looked and says, Lord, where are we going to go? You're the one that's preaching the words of eternal life. Where can we go? I mean, they had given up everything in order to follow him. They understood the cost of what it was to be a disciple. The others, okay, they were looking for an easier life. They said, you know what, I'm just not cut out for what you want us to do, Jesus. But the 12 said, you know what, I know what you're asking us to do. We can't go anywhere else. We know you're preaching the truth. And I want to tell you this, and this is the sad thing. But being a disciple of Christ is not for everybody. God wants it to be for everybody. But it's obviously not for everybody, because again, we just saw this, that many, many walked away. It's kind of like, you guys ever watch that show, the Navy SEAL training? I love that show. You know, I'm a guy, and you know, I sit there looking at them training, going, I could do that, you know? Right, guys? Come on, I'm not the only one. You guys are doing the same thing, you know? But we're looking at it going, you know, this is a man thing, okay? This is a tough thing to do, you know, to be accepted into the SEAL training. Matter of fact, to become a Navy SEAL, there's a greater chance that you have to get selected to an NFL football team than becoming a Navy SEAL. I mean, this is hardcore stuff here, okay? And there's a great reward for those that can make it, complete the training, all right? And they become a Navy SEALs, and they get to do this top secret stuff and everything. But in order to complete that, okay, they've got to be absolutely disciplined. They've got to be focused on their training. They've got to be focused on that reward. And again, obviously, it's not for everybody, because very, very few people can make it, okay? Now, understand this, okay? The Christian walk is similar to this. Obviously, it's not for everybody, and you've got to understand something. In order to follow, and I'm going to make a statement here, okay? And this is where we're going with the rest of this sermon, okay? In order to follow the Rabbi Yeshua, okay? Yeshua is Jesus' Hebrew word, and Jesus was a rabbi, okay? It's going to take some sacrifice. It's not going to be easy to be a true disciple of Rabbi Yeshua, okay? Jesus was a rabbi. He was called a rabbi many, many times from childhood. Of course, he was the best of the best at interpreting the Torah. I mean, he had a little advantage, didn't he? Remember when they left him at the temple? And he's over there, and he's 12 years old, and he's teaching the rabbis? And I don't know if we completely understand that. If you know the training, I'm going to share with you in just a minute, the training it takes to become a rabbi. But Jesus is sitting there teaching the rabbis. I mean, he was a teacher. He was a rabbi. He was a teacher of the law. That's who Jesus was. Now, let me just give you a little process of what it takes to become a rabbi, okay? And you've got to understand this, so bear with me for just a minute in order to really understand what a true disciple of Christ is. To become a rabbi, there's kind of an intense educational process. When you're a Jewish kid, in the ages of 6 to 10 years old, you go to an elementary-type school, all right? Everyone goes to it. It's called a Bet Sefer, and what you do is you go into the temple, or into the synagogue, I should say, and a rabbi comes out. And the first thing he does is he gives you a little slate. Now, can you imagine being 6 years old and this rabbi comes out in this synagogue here, stands over you, hands you a slate because you're going to start writing down the Torah. And the first thing he does is he gets out some honey and he squirts honey on that slate. And he says, try the honey. So all these six-year-olds are digging in, you know, and go, this is good. And the rabbi looks and says, you know what? God's word is sweeter than that. And for the next 4 or 5 years, they are memorizing the entire Torah until they're 10 years old. When they get out of the first level of training, the Bet Sefer, okay, they know the entire Torah. If you don't know what Torah is, it's the first five books of your Bible. Can you imagine? By the time you're 10 years old, you have the first five books absolutely memorized. So if you went to a 10-year-old, all right, you could say, tell me what Exodus 15 is, all right? And they would think for a minute and go, and they would start rattling it off. That's how well they know the Torah. That's what it's all about, okay? That God's word is sweeter than anything else. You memorize the Torah. Now, the best of the best, okay, in this first process of Beit Sefer, okay, continue on to this upper school called Bet Midrash. And Bet Midrash is for kids ages, you know, around 13, 15 years old. And not only do they memorize the Torah, but they memorize the Tanakh, okay? And that is not only the first five books, but that's the entire Old Testament. They memorize it word for word. They know it all. Now, the best of the best of Bet Midrash, they move on to another kind of an upper type of school. It's called Bet Talmud, okay? In the ages of 13 to 30. You guys hanging with me for a minute? You've got to catch this. You've got to understand some Jewish culture so you can understand really what a disciple of Christ is. Okay, so they go on to this Bet Talmud, and it's the final leg of their education, and this is the pinnacle. Okay, all Jewish kids want to enter this whole thing called Bet Talmud, because what it is, it's really discipleship training in order to become a rabbi. And all kids, all Jewish kids, would love to become a rabbi, because again, this is probably the most honorable thing that you can become, is a teacher of the law. Ever since they were a little kid, they were just trained up with the Word of God. And when they get older, they want to be able to teach that as well. So again, they all want to go through this. But again, only the best of the best is going to enter this upper level. Very, very select few get to go in and be under this training of Bet Talmud, okay? It's in Bet Talmud, what it is, it's almost one-on-one training with the rabbi. Okay, the rabbi will go out and he will select from the best of the best, okay, for just a handful of disciples that are going to follow him, okay? And this is what Bet Talmud is all about. He selects the best, and again, very few were selected. And once you were selected, it was such an honorable thing that you would leave everything. Remember when Jesus selected his disciples and said they cast their nets and they left everything? Okay, so you've got to understand this process so you can understand the process that Jesus goes by of selecting disciples. They left everything, all right? And the whole goal of this whole Bet Talmud was to emulate every single move of the rabbi. The goal was to become exactly like the rabbi. Matter of fact, there's a term called covered by the dust of your rabbi. And what it meant was you followed your rabbi so close that his dust would be upon you. You went everywhere with him, okay? Matter of fact, there's another thing about sitting at the rabbi's feet, okay? So if you're the rabbi's here teaching, okay, you'd be sitting at his feet. And as he's kicking the dirt and that kind of thing, the dust is coming up. And it says, be covered by the dust of your rabbi. Stay that close, okay? Eat, sleep, talk, clean, dress, just like your rabbi. And the number one thing is this, that you understand the interpretation of the word of how your rabbi does. So you actually become just like your rabbi. Matter of fact, remember Paul in Acts 22, it says that Paul sat at the feet of Gamaliel. Anybody remember that? Gamaliel was a rabbi. He is probably one of the most famous rabbis that there ever was. And this shows how smart Paul was. Very, very few select people ever sat at the feet of Gamaliel. This is the process that was taking place in order for Paul to become a rabbi. He was involved in this whole process. He was one of the best of the best. It's to sit at the feet of your rabbi and having that dust, okay, of your rabbi come upon you. Now again, Jesus was a rabbi. He taught in the synagogues. So again, he had to go through this whole process as well. And again, he had a little advantage. He wrote the word. Matter of fact, he didn't write the word. He was the word, right? So when they said, Jesus, would you go ahead and memorize this verse or whatever? He'd go, well, that's not difficult. I wrote it, right? Matter of fact, it's who I am. It'd be like somebody tell me, can you memorize the name Brett Mackey? You know, that's who I am. You know, and when they said, Jesus, you need to memorize this, he had a little bit of advantage, guys. He was the word, okay? It wasn't hard for him to memorize himself. Remember when Jesus, I talked about this a minute ago, he was left at the temple and he was with these other rabbis? I think this was part of the process of him going into this Bet Talmud, that he was with other rabbis, okay, sitting at their feet, all right? He was teaching them, okay? He said, I must be about my Father's business. You remember that what age he was when he came into public ministry? He was 30. That was the same time that you would be graduating from this Bet Talmud, all right? So Jesus went through this process as well. And since Jesus was a rabbi, and once he was a rabbi, it took place, or he had to take part in the process of what I've just been explaining. And he needed a small number of disciples to emulate him. And by the way, as he was going through this process, this is why many people think that the disciples were actually pretty young. You know, some of us think that his disciples were, you know, 30, 40, 50 years old. They weren't. They would have been going through the same process. And a lot of his disciples might have been in their mid-teens to early 20s at best. And, you know, that's why John was able to write in the island of Patmos the book of Revelation in, what, year 92 AD or whatever. If he'd have been 40 or 50 years old when he started following Jesus, he'd have been dead. So a lot of these disciples are young because, again, they were going through this process, okay? And the disciples' goal, when Jesus came and said, why don't you come and follow me, be my disciple, the process of being a disciple of Christ was to sit at the feet of Yeshua. It was to be covered by his dust, to be that close. It was to become exactly like who Jesus was. And today, the same thing goes for you and I to be a disciple of Christ. We are still in this process that our goal as a disciple of Christ is to become just like our rabbi, Yeshua, Jesus Christ. That is who we are supposed to be as a disciple of Christ. And as his disciples became more and more like Christ, people began to notice. They said, oh yeah, you're following that guy that claims he's the Christ? We'll just call you Christian. And it was a more of a mocking thing is what it was at first. Okay, Christian, okay, you're following the Christ, because again, most of them didn't believe it. But that's really where the term Christian came from, because his disciples became so much like him in every way that they looked and said, just like Christ, we'll call him Christian. Now, why don't I share the last 10 minutes about that whole process? And this is why. Because Jesus doesn't change. He is the same yesterday, today, and he will be forever. And Jesus, by the way, is still calling people to be his disciple. He is still rabbi. And he's calling you and I to sit at his feet and to be so close to him that the dust of his feet will be covering us. Matthew chapter 11, verse 27 says this: all things have been delivered to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father. Nor does anyone know the Father except the Son, and the one to whom the Son wills reveal him. Okay, verse 28. Okay, come to me, all you labor, and this is what I want you to see here. Come to me, all, man, I'm botching this up. Come to me, all you who labor and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. In verse 29, here it is. It says, take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest in my souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. So again, what I want you to see here is this. When a rabbi would call somebody into this whole process of Ben Talmud, okay, getting them to train up to be a disciple, to someday be a teacher of the word, they would use a certain phrase, and Jesus used the same phrase here. This is what they would say. They would say, come follow me. Matthew 11, 29 says, the rabbi would say this, take my yoke upon you and learn from me. So again, this is what Jesus was saying, not only to his physical disciples, but he's saying to you and to me. He's saying, take my yoke, come and follow me. This is the rabbi's invitation that you come and follow him. And then he goes on and says, for I am gentle, lowly at heart, and you'll find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Now, again, he says, take my yoke. Now, this term yoke is often misinterpreted. Okay, many people think this yoke is, you know, like what you strap on the back of an oxen, or you see a prisoner with that yoke on, and it's this heavy type of thing. And that is in some cases. But when you're talking about a rabbi saying, take on my yoke, what it's talking about is this. Your yoke is learning your rabbi's interpretations of the law. So Jesus is saying, learn how I am telling you to obey the commands of God. And he's saying, when you learn the way I'm telling you to interpret it, not the way the other rabbis and the Pharisees and all them are telling you to interpret it, but when you learn how I'm telling you to take my yoke on, it's not going to be heavy. Matter of fact, he's saying it's going to set you free. But in order to be his disciple that he's calling you to be, you've got to sit at his feet, you've got to be covered by his dust, you've got to enter this learning process, the Bet Talmud, where you literally become just like the rabbi. And who's your rabbi? That's right, Jesus Christ. That's what a disciple of Christ is. That you're becoming more and more and more like him every single day because you're sitting at his feet. You're learning about him. You're learning the way he wants you to interpret his word. You're learning how Jesus obeyed the commands of the Father. And now listen to me. His yoke, he says, it's not heavy. And when you start to follow Christ, the yoke, talking about obeying the commands of the Father, are not heavy. And here's why. Because they eventually become very natural to you. Okay? As you start to become more and more like Christ, and I'm just thinking about this in my life, okay? It's more abnormal for me anymore. And I'm not saying that I'm right, because he's just begun a good work in me. But again, the closer I get to Christ, the more I follow him, it's more abnormal for me anymore not to obey the commands of God. It's more of a natural thing. And then the reason why is because your whole motivation changes when you become a disciple of Christ. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old things pass away. Behold, all things become new. Okay? Now again, you are saved by grace through faith. Okay? Through faith. You are saved by the blood of Jesus Christ, by his sacrifice. That is how you're saved. And I've said that several times, so I don't want you to misinterpret. It's a works-based salvation, all right? You are saved freely by his sacrifice on the cross. That's how your sins are shed away. But again, as you are saved, the demonstration that you are saved is your works. And that's what he's talking about here, okay? Your obedience to him, all right? Now, the reason why your whole motivation changes is because you understand this. A true disciple of Christ understands the consequences of sin, that there is a literal hell waiting for those people that have any sin within your life. You cannot stand before a holy God and survive. You've got to be free. You've got to be pure. And you can't do that on your own, but it only takes by the shedding of a blood of the Lamb of God that can remove that from you. And again, those true disciples of Christ truly understand the consequences of their sin, and they truly understand the punishment that Jesus went through for us. And listen to me, you don't look to obey God because it's the law. That's legalism, that you obey God's commands because you have to. But you begin in obedience to obey God, not because it's a law, but because it's out of love for what Jesus has done for you. You guys get this? You see the difference here? And I want to tell you something, that if his yoke is still heavy for you, then you need to check your salvation. Because he says right here that my yoke won't be heavy for you. It's talking about obeying the commands of God. If you still have a hard time obeying the commands of God, okay, you need to examine yourself. Have you really been changed? And again, this is Jesus' words. His words always demands an examination of the heart. He's just not going to throw something out there just for the fun of it. He wants everybody to examine themselves. So again, when you are a true disciple of Christ, it's not a hard thing to follow the law. Yeah, we struggle sometimes. Once in a while, we stumble. But again, it becomes natural because your motivation changes. Let me just give you a quick little modern-day parable, a little example here. Okay? I don't know if you guys go to Walmart on Baltimore. You guys, anybody do that? Okay, you take Baltimore. The speed limit has always been 45. I've lived out there since I was been a kid, you know, went around that way, and now I live out that direction. So I'm always going over that thing. And speed limit, you know, when you're going by the lake there, you know where the baseball field is, railroad tracks, baseball field, that kind of thing. It's always been 45 right there. They're starting to build houses there now. They changed it from 45 to 30. You guys notice that? It's a pain in the rear end. And I want to tell you, it's a law now that it's 30 miles an hour, okay? And I try to obey the law. But the law, I want to tell you, at 30 miles an hour is a heavy burden for me. A guy that is always in a hurry, and a guy that knows that there is a train coming across that track every 5 minutes, all right? And when I come over that hill and I see it's clear, I don't want to slow down. I want to gun it, okay? Because I don't want to be caught by a train, all right? The law that has changed is a heavy burden to me because it's the law. So I am called to obey it. I don't like it, but I try to obey it. Okay, sometimes I bend it a little bit. And I didn't paint over that 30 miles an hour, by the way, that up there. Now, here's the difference in motivation, though. When my son a couple years ago was playing coach pitch baseball, Jackson was as well. Yeah, there's Jackson right there. I can't see in the lights. But we played at this baseball field right there, all right? And I want to tell you something, guys. 30 miles an hour is not slow enough when you got kids playing there. Right? You see the difference? You see the motivation change? See, I don't want people to drive slower because it's the law. I want people to drive slower in that area because out of my love for my kids and for my protection. And when you truly understand what Christ has done for you, you see, this motivation changes. And again, his yoke does not become heavy because you're not obeying him because it's part of the law, something you have to do. You're obeying him because your love for him and your protection that you want for the entire body of Christ. You see this shift? There is a shift in why you obey or you follow the yoke of Jesus Christ. See, becoming a disciple isn't about acquiring a new revelation of the law. Becoming a disciple of Christ is about a new revolution of your soul. When we become a follower of Christ, that he's our rabbi, we will be transformed like him, and there will be a noticeable change in our life. We look at the scriptures. Moved by undeserved love, we see this guy, Zacchaeus. You remember the story? This tax collector? Everybody hated him. This greedy man? Moved because of the undeserved love that Christ gave to him, he was transformed in a moment. He gave half of the money away to the poor. He gave four times the amount to the people that he cheated. And people took notice. They said, here is a sinner. He used to be this greedy tax collector, and now he's turning into this generous guy because his motivation has changed. See, as a disciple of Christ, the question that I need to ask you this morning is, does the world notice a difference in you? Does the world act differently around you because they know that you're a God-fearing person? Do they act differently? I was at a couple weeks, actually last Friday. Remember when some of you were here and we showed Courageous? The reason I wasn't there is because I'm coaching baseball this year on Hastings A's. And I was at one of their fundraising banquets that I was required to be at. And I was in the crowd. They asked me to pray before it started. I thought, that's kind of cool. So anyway, I pray and I go sit back down. And one of the MCs stands up. And one of the first things out of his mouth, he looked and he says, you know what? I guess because Brett's here, I guess I can't cuss and I can't say dirty jokes, so I guess that takes 75% of what I was going to say away. And he was kind of joking. I'm sitting there going, wait a minute. We got 8, 9, 10-year-olds, so it shouldn't even be anything to do with me. You shouldn't be telling dirty jokes and shouldn't be cutting up and cussing and stuff because there's kids involved, number one. But again, the whole time he was doing this MC, every time he'd say something a little bit off-cover, he'd look and go, sorry, Brett, that kind of thing, okay? And, you know, I started taking a little offense to this, okay? And my wife was too, and she's sitting by me going, okay, you get the mic next, you get him, all right? You get up there. By the way, you never, ever say something bad about somebody when they're going to get the mic next, okay? Just a little word for you, okay? And I'm sitting there just kind of stewing, going, I do this for a living, okay? I should be able to get him good, all right? So I'm thinking, okay, what am I going to say when I get up there? And, you know, I thought, well, maybe I should stand up and say, well, I guess I can't say anything uplifting and encouraging to anybody because so-and-so's sitting here, you know? I thought about saying that, and I thought more, you know what? I'm not going to respond to this guy, all right? Because you know what? And the more I thought about it, the more I was not offended, and the more I thought, you know what? This is how it should be. This is really how it should be, that when people know you stand for Christ, they should take notice, and it should cause their actions to change, whether good or bad, whether they're going to mock you or respect you, but something's got to change because they've got to learn, how am I going to deal with this God-fearing man in this R-related type of world that we live in? And the question for you is, was Jesus mocked? Yeah, did people maybe not get Jesus? Are you called to be exactly like him as a disciple of Christ? Are you going to get mocked? Okay, are you going to have people go, I don't quite get you? Yes, you will. That's what a disciple of Christ will go through. Because you are becoming exactly like him in all of your behavior, everything that you do. Now, here's the interesting thing as I'm getting ready to close here about this Rabbi Jesus calling disciples. Now, remember the process I just talked about, how once you went into this Bet Talmud, okay, it was the best of the best. Okay, a rabbi would look for the best of the best, okay? He would look for the person, okay, that knew the Bible or the word at that time, the law at that time, inside and out, okay? They didn't select anybody, okay, that wasn't just incredibly gifted in the word of God. And very, very few ever got chosen because, again, it was just this elite level. That is who got to enter this. That's who got to be a disciple of Christ. And you might be sitting here right now thinking about this, saying, wow, I'm not part of the elite. Okay, I don't even know if I can repeat John 3:16, maybe you might be saying, let alone the whole Torah and tonic and all that kind of stuff. How in the world will I ever get chosen to be a disciple if that's what it requires, that you've got to be the elite, the best of the best, in order to get chosen to be a disciple? There is no hope for me. Here is the good news for you about Rabbi Yeshua, Jesus Christ. Jesus never, ever went after the best. He never did. He never called a single Pharisee. He never called a scribe. He never called a Sadducee. He never called anybody from any type of scholarly background, like every other rabbi did. Jesus didn't do that. You know who he called? He called about five or six uneducated, undisciplined fishermen. He called some unethical tax collector. He called a zealot to be his disciple. You know what a zealot was? They wanted Rome out of there, so they went around killing Romans. He called one of them. He called a small town farmer to follow him. Okay, what I'm trying to get at is Jesus went and he called ordinary people like you, like me, not people that were the elite, the best of the best. None of these men that he called had any type of scholarly pedigree. All of them had probably already been rejected from any other rabbi, because you know why? Because they're already serving in their family trait. They're fishermen or whatever. So they had been rejected. They'd been thrown out of the education system. Okay, there was no hope for them anymore to become a rabbi, which would have been a goal for every kid. And Jesus comes along and calls them. Now, here's what I want you to see here. Peter and John, they're part of Jesus' inner circle. Okay, they aren't just part of the 12. I mean, they were part of the three. Pete, Jim, and John went everywhere with Jesus. Okay, they were part of this inner circle. But the thing that we need to see here is they never appeared to be outside, or to the outside world, as extraordinary. They never were. They weren't skilled in too much. They didn't have this great charisma. They weren't skilled speakers. And in Acts 4, we talked about this, I think last week, that they went and they God used them to heal this lame person. The religious leaders didn't quite understand it. And they said, come here. I want to talk to you. How in the world did you do that? What authority did you have to heal that person? I mean, that's just ridiculous. Somebody does something incredible like that, and they're questioning this person. So they gave Peter a platform, which you never wanted to do to a fisherman like Peter, all right? And he let him have it. It says that he preached the word boldly. He said, I did this because it's only through the power of Jesus Christ. And he began to preach the gospel boldly. Now look in Acts 4:13. It says, now when they, talking about the scribes and the Sadducees, the people that the religious leader that called them forward, when they saw the boldness in Peter and John, and look at this. It says, and perceived that they were unlearned and an ignorant man, they marveled and they took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus. Now I want you to see something real quick. See that word ignorant right there? This word in the Greek, and I think I have it back there, is this word right there, idiotes. And idiotes means that they were unlearned, they're illiterate, they're men that are opposed to the learned and the educated, okay? They're one who is unskilled at any art. That word idiotes right there, that's where we get our American word idiot. These scribes looked at Jesus' two best disciples and said, they look like a bunch of idiots. But yet it says, not only did they look like idiots or unlearned, uneducated, and whoever's a worship leader, if you want to come up because I'm about ready to close here, they looked at these top disciples and again said, you look like idiots. But guys, on the other hand, they were marveled at what they said. And it says that they knew that they'd been with Jesus. There was no way, they said, that you could do this on your own because you're just ordinary people. You're not these skilled scholars or whatever. You're these ordinary people, and we know that you've been with Jesus because there's no way that you could have done that. They marvel at them. And this is what I want you to see as we're getting ready to close, okay? God will take an ordinary person, and what makes it so amazing is that when you're ordinary, and that's who he's looking for, he will take an ordinary person and do a supernatural, extraordinary thing in you. And because of that, the world will be marveled at you. This is why Jesus chose these disciples. You guys remember Paul Potts? You ever heard that name before? Okay, American Idol or whatever, that Britain's Got Talent or something like that. Showed this clip a couple years ago. I want to show it one more time because I want to drive a point home before we close. Okay, this is what looks like the world would say an ordinary person. And when an ordinary person does an extraordinary thing, just look how the world marvels over this.
But for the next contestant, the world of showbiz seems a million miles away.
It's Paul, a mobile phone salesman from South Wales.
By day, I sell mobile phones. My dream is to spend my life doing what I feel that I was born to do.
Paul, what are you here for today, Paul?
To sing opera. I've always wanted to sing as a career. Confidence has always been sort of like a difficult thing for me. I've always found it a little bit difficult to be completely confident in myself.
Okay, ready when you are.
At Carphone Warehouse, and you did that. I wasn't expecting that.
No, neither was I.
This was a complete breath of fresh air. I thought you were absolutely fantastic.
You have to take an ordinary person that the world might label an idiotase, an uneducated person that maybe isn't the best of the best. And Jesus says, I'm calling you. And I want to take an ordinary person and I want to do an extraordinary thing through you because I want the world to marvel at you. See, it's not a big deal, guys, if some superstar does something that a superstar should. That's what they're supposed to do. That's why Jesus didn't go after a superstar. And if you're a superstar in here, okay, he can probably still use you. But if you're an ordinary person, like me, like every single person here, because I don't know any superstars that we have in here, whatever a superstar may be, I think we're all pretty ordinary people. And God wants to take an ordinary person, call you as his disciple. He wants you to get so close to him that the dust is covering you, that's coming off of you. And he wants to do something unbelievable for you as a disciple. You don't want to know why? Because you're not going to get the credit. He doesn't want no superstar to take the credit for what he's doing. He wants to use an ordinary person, call you guys, do something incredible through you that the whole world's going to be marveled. They're going to look and say, you've been with Jesus, right? This is who he's calling you to be, his disciple. This is what he wants to do through you. 2 Corinthians 12:9 says, my gracious favor is all you need. My power works best in your weakness. When you think you're weak, he's looking saying, there's my opportunity. When his power manifests in your weakness, the only thing that we can do is give glory to God. It's not of me. It's all completely of him because you know your natural ability. It's just ordinary. When you choose to become his disciple, he's going to take an ordinary person and do an extraordinary thing through you. God calls you great names. you're going to submit to him. He calls you saved. He calls you Israel. He calls you overcomer. He's called you healer. And he's calling you right now, everybody, to take his yoke. Take my yoke. Sit at his feet. Be covered by his dust. Become just like him. He's calling you to be his disciple. Amen? Amen. Why don't you stand up and let's pray.